Today I'm designing a complete 2D platformer app pack entirely in Inkscape, including the environment, some characters and a few simple animations. What you're seeing right now is the final result, everything animated in Blender and brought into Godot to build a small playable demo. In this video I want to show you how I personally approach making game art like this using only Inkscape for drawing and Blender for 2D animation, and hopefully inspire you by showing what's possible with vector illustration for games. I've also included all of these assets, including the animations, in my free Inkscape pack, which you can download for free. You'll find the link in the description. If you're interested in learning how to draw this kind of art, make sure to subscribe to the channel. I got a lot of free step-by-step tutorials, and if you really want to learn and master Inkscape, make sure to stay until the end, because I got something you might be interested in. The first thing I like to do when making art for a game is to create a rough mock-up level. This is incredibly useful to get the proportions right and to better visualize how the assets should fit together. I usually start by making a simple rectangular shape with the proportions of the screen. This makes it easy to decide how big everything should be. Then I add a few more rectangles to establish things like the ground height and the character scale. I'm not trying to design an actual level here, although you can use this method for that. The goal is really to get a clear sense of scale, spacing and overall feel, so I can design the asset with that in mind from the start. The first real decision you have to make when creating a platformer like this is whether you're going to use a tileset or not. Not using a tileset can be faster at first, but it usually means a lot of back and forth between the engine and Inkscape. Since I'm planning to distribute these assets, using a tileset just makes more sense, especially for people who want to quickly drop things into their own projects. In this case, the tileset is only for the terrain. It's basically split into two parts, a top section with grass, and a bottom section made of ground with some simple patterns, so it's not just a flat color. This is a very common approach in platformers, going all the way back to classic 8-bit games. To make the tileset more flexible, I'm also creating a few variations, both in pattern and color. To make color changes easier, I'm taking advantage of transparency. Everything here, including the ground details, is built using black and white shapes with alpha transparency. The result is that changing the base color automatically affects all the details. This lets you quickly create lots of color variations before exporting. I'm sure you could handle color changes inside Godot using some shaders, and that may be more efficient, but for a simple demo like this, it feels unnecessary. To add more visual interest to the ground, I'm also making a few small decorative elements to place on top, like simple holes or this skull. Little details like this go a long way in breaking up repetition and adding personality. I also want a couple of floating platforms. You could make them more tile friendly, but for this demo, I don't think it's really needed. I'll just make two or three variations with different lengths. Next come the props that help you dress up the level. To save some time, I'm reusing some assets from other pack that's included in my free Inkscape download. That pack was originally made for building backgrounds, but a lot of these assets work surprisingly well with just a few tweaks. In fact, most of the props you see in the final demo come from that pack. I didn't really plan this, but it makes sense since I originally designed them to be generic and flexible enough to work in many different contexts. I did modify some of them, and of course I added a couple of new elements as well, which in this case are these bones and this meat power-up. Once animated, they really will help to bring the scene to life. For the characters, I started with this caveman character I had already designed. In fact, the idea for the game really started with the character, and everything else was built around it. For the enemies, I didn't think it was necessary to design a whole bunch of them, so I quickly sketch out this little dinosaur. Now it's time to animate everything, and for that I'm using Blender. If you're new to the channel, I've been using Blender as a 2D animation tool for quite a while now, and I've been consistently surprised by how powerful it is. is definitely way more complex than most 2D tools, and sometimes it can feel a bit unintuitive, but if you're really looking for an open source solution for 2D animation, Blender is extremely capable. As I mentioned earlier, I'm also animating some of the assets to make the level feel more alive. The bone collectibles get a subtle movement, the same with this power-up. Some of the foliage has a gentle wind motion, and even the clouds have a soft breathing animation. For the characters, the dinosaur enemy only needs a simple walk animation for this demo. I didn't plan any attack or death logic, so keeping it simple makes sense. The most complex animation is the main caveman. Ideally, I'd like to separate run animations from facing left and right, since he's holding a club on one side, but I don't really have the time to solve all the layering issues that would come with that, so I'm sticking to a single run animation and flipping it in the engine. I'm also adding a quick idle animation. And then there is the jump. I'm making a single animation and handling the upward and downward motion inside of the engine. When the character is going up, it plays the first half of the animation, and when it's coming down, it plays the second half. It's a simple trick, but it makes the jump feel more visually interesting. Once the animations are done, it's time to move everything into Godot. I'm not going to go deep into the programming side here. This video is about art, but I do want to show you how I set things up at a basic level. With the project created and the assets imported, the first thing I do is to set up the tilemap. Godot makes this really straightforward, just like with everything. That's one of the reasons I enjoy working with it. After that, I block out the level. I'm not overthinking the layout here. I'm mostly improvising and going with what feels right. This is meant to be a visual demo, not a careful design game level. Then I start setting up all the interactive objects. Anything that needs more than a basic sprite 2D becomes its own scene, like the moving foliage, the collectibles, and the power-up. Next come the enemies and the main character. I already showed you how to set up animated characters in a previous video, so I'm not repeating that here. The main difference is that now I'm using some quick ChatGPT generated code to handle movement and basic logic, though if you can program manually, I'm sure that's better. Finally, I assemble everything in the main scene. I drag in all the scenes I created, but I also directly drag in PNG images for things that don't need interaction, like the background trees or mountains. It might not be the best practice, but it's fast and works well for this kind of demo. And here is the result once everything is in place. Even at this point, it already feels surprisingly close to a real game. And just like that, we already have a simple, playable level. It really wasn't that hard. And remember, you can download the same asset pack I use here. The link is in the description. If you'd like to learn how to actually draw this kind of art in Inkscape, you can check out my 13 courses bundle. It's about 70 hours of tutorials covering character design, background design, game art, and more. All aimed at beginners who want to draw using just a keyboard and mouse. I think this is especially useful for developers who are comfortable with programming, but don't feel confident about art. Vector drawing is different enough from traditional drawing that it can really open a new path into making art for your games. It definitely did it for me. And that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed the video, and more importantly, that it inspired you to make your own game. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and let me know what you'd like me to cover next in the comments. See you next week. Bye!